news and they've told you to make sure that you have the proper lenses to stare into the eclipse, because it can be dangerous to you if you stare into the eclipse. But can I talk about staring into eclipse? Staring into a spiritual eclipse. See, a solar eclipse is a type of eclipse that occurs when the moon passes between the sun and the earth, and when the moon fully or partially blocks the sun from the earth. This can happen only in a new moon, when the sun and the moon are in conjunction with the earth's alignment. And so here it is: a solar eclipse occurs when there is this almost straight line between the sun, the earth, and the moon. In a total eclipse, the sun is fully obscured by the moon. In a partial eclipse or an annular eclipse, part of the sun is obscured by the moon. And so an eclipse is a natural phenomenon. It is something that some of us have experienced in our lifetime. But the reality is, eclipses happen almost literally every year, multiple times of year, in different places on this planet. And so it is a part of nature. It is a part of the cycles of the universe and our solar system. It is a natural phenomenon. But however, in biblical times, in ancient times, in those times, solar eclipses were looked at as being supernatural. They were caused by supernatural beings, and they were a sign of bad omens. One of the Greek historians talks about two warring factions who had been engaged in war for numerous years. One, doing a solar eclipse, literally, they put down their tools of war and ended the war on that day because they felt like something was happening. Christopher Columbus, while in Jamaica, he was there, and he knew that an eclipse was coming. See, the natives in Jamaica had taken care of Columbus, had provided him food, and they said, "Well, you've been here too long. You have overstayed your welcome. You need to get on and move out." You know how folk move into your house and they just have a tendency to overstay their welcome. Well, Columbus had overstayed his welcome, and the natives wanted him to go, so they stopped supplying him with food. Well, Columbus knew that a solar eclipse was coming, so he told them that, "If you don't give me food, I'm going to make the sun disappear." Columbus went back to his tent, and later on that day, the sun disappeared. And don't you know, the natives continued to give him food. He used it to his advantage. And so this has been a part of a natural phenomenon in the world since the very beginning of time. Just the way that the universe is constructed was put together by God. It is a system where solar eclipses happen on particular cycles. Every solar eclipse occurs in a particular cycle. And in most cases, a solar eclipse will hit the same place every 54 odd years. Now, a total eclipse occurs when the dark silhouette of the moon totally covers the intense bright light of the sun, allowing a much fainter solar corona to be viewed. And so that when you look at pictures of the eclipse, that ring that is around the moon, that is called a corona, not the beer that you're going to drink after church, but... And an annular eclipse occurs when the sun or the moon is exactly aligned with the earth, but the moon appears smaller. And so only a portion of the moon blocks the sun. A hybrid eclipse is when there is an annular eclipse and a total eclipse. And so it shifts between the two. And then there is a partial eclipse. A partial eclipse occurs when the sun and the moon aren't exactly in line with the earth, but it blocks the sun in such a way. And so now that I've given you what this thing called a solar eclipse is, so that you will be able to understand what is happening tomorrow, can I talk to you about a spiritual eclipse? See, we're in the midst of a spiritual eclipse right now. I think ever since the birth of this nation, we've been in the midst of a spiritual eclipse. A spiritual eclipse occurs when Satan passes between you and the sun. Somebody's gonna get that in a minute. Yeah. Not the S-U-N, but the S-O-N. Wait, somebody just missed that. A solar eclipse is when Satan passes between you and the sun. The S-O-N. Y'all still haven't got it. When Satan passes between you and the sun, fully or partially blocks your sight of the sun. I don't know if you've ever had any of those moments in your life where Satan just jumped right in front of you and Jesus, and you were trying to see your way out of a situation, but you just couldn't seem to see around Satan, and so you started to doubt if the sun was still. Y'all not with me. See, when a man or woman is distracted from his or her purpose or promise, they're in the midst of an eclipse. When you are distracted from what God has called you to do, you are in the midst of an eclipse. If we explore the Gospel of John, we see how Jesus was constantly under attack. There were entities that were trying to step in between him and God, trying to block the one he had his eyes on. Y'all not hearing me this morning. I think there were three things that tried to block him from seeing or doing what God called him to do. The first thing, if you look through and you read through the entire Gospel of John, John is a great gospel, and it is not a part of the synoptics. It's a part of the synoptics, but it's not like Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's very different. John is almost like a letter of recommendation for Jesus, and so when you read through John, the first thing you notice is that this whole notion of legalism. See, legalism, and so Jesus is constantly dealing with legalism. Don't you know legalism will get in your way? What is legalism, Reverend Robinson? See, legalism is strict, literal, or excessive conformity to the law or to a religious or moral code. You know how folk get up in the church and stuff has to be a particular, it has to be this way because you, y'all not with me. See, if you jump over to John 5, here it is. In John 5, Jesus heals a man who has been lame. Yet the folk in the church come to Jesus and say, wait, you healed him on the Sabbath. The man was healed, but they were caught up in the legality of what the church is supposed to, you know, the rules of the church, the tradition. Y'all not hearing me. And so they didn't even want the man to be, that they were caught up. See, legalism will cause an eclipse in your spirituality. See, the Pharisees, they followed the law of Moses, and they were so caught up. They were so caught up in the law of Moses that they were forgetting about the suffering of the people around them. Legalism will mess you up. Legalism is in the church today. We get so caught up in tradition, so caught up in the way things supposed to be, so caught up in all of these things that hinder us from creating really positive relationships with people outside the church. But the next thing, so legalism, it creates this eclipse. But the next thing, literalism. Let's see, a literalism is an adherence to an explicit substance of an idea or an expression. Now, if you read through the Gospel of John, even in this first chapter, go to the very first few verses. Here it is. Jesus, Nicodemus comes to Jesus in the midnight hour. He comes to Jesus under the cover of darkness. And Jesus tells Nicodemus, to tell Nicodemus, you have to be born again. Well, Nicodemus takes him literally. Nicodemus says, well, I can't travel back through my mother's womb. If you read through the rest of the Gospels of John, everyone seems to take him literally. The woman at the well, in Samaria, Jesus says, well, I have some water where you won't be thirsty again. And here it is. The woman says, well, give me this water so I don't have to come to the well anymore. Throughout the Bible, even the disciples take Jesus literally. The disciples take him literally. But in the church today, the problem that Jesus was dealing with is Jesus was looking at the scripture of the Old Testament, and the Pharisees and the Sadducees were taking it literally. And so that's why they looked at it and they said, well, you can't heal on the Sabbath. They said, you can't do A, B, C, D. We in the church, we look at the Bible, we look at it literally, and we take, I know, some people don't like that. We read it literally, but we don't put it into context. We don't look at the history of what was going on. And so if you don't have any context, don't you know that the text is a con? And so legalism, literalism, and then the last one is labeling. Labeling, a word or phrase that describes the identity of something or someone. If you read through the Gospel of John, there's a whole lot of labeling going on. And in John 4, when the woman is at the well, she says, wait, you a Jew. I don't hang with folk like you. And so here it is. This whole notion, labeling, messes us up, and it causes this eclipse in our spirituality. Romans labeled the Jews, the Jews labeled the Romans. All of this labeling around us, all of this labeling, even when you look at the events of last week, it's all about labeling. About people labeling other people and trying to place them in a position that they want them to be in. Yeah. And so even we label people in the church and we label people outside the church, which causes an eclipse in our spirituality. Too often we forget what God is calling us to do. The problem is, in the events of last week, here it is. This small segment of the population is so mad that they're losing their, that they feel like they're losing their way. They wanting to create this white ethno state, but I think that the United States is already. We get caught up. We get caught up in labeling our brothers and our sisters. We put people in these boxes and we say that they're not this, they're not that, and we push them away. And so Jesus was dealing with this whole notion of being a label. He understood. If you look at the author of John is speaking to a community, reminding them that the light is in the world, yet people have failed to recognize the light because of their selfish ambition and their love of evil. Yeah. If you look at the text that we just read, if you read through that text, the author is saying, folk have forgotten. Now, if you go up a few verses, John 3:16 is one of the most popular texts in the Bible. Most people know John 3:16, but people don't read past that. The author is saying that they so caught up, that they're so caught up that they forgot what God has called them to do. To really understand this, to put this into context, you have to understand light. Light meant truth in the Bible. And so we think about light and we look at it from this. We flick on the light. If we got our cell phone, we use it for a flashlight. We don't worry about light. Even because we live in a suburban or a city area, when we look up at night, we can't see all the stars in the sky because there's so much light around us. But if you go back to biblical times, when it was dark, When the sun went down, it was dark. And if you didn't have, wait, see, if you didn't have a lamp, you stumbled, you tripped. That was things that you fell over things. What, y'all still not getting it? See, the people, in the biblical experience, just like us, you know, folk waited for the nighttime because it was the right time. Somebody remember that song. Yeah. The nighttime is the right time to what? Be with what? y'all not here. Y'all ain't been in church y'all whole life. And so the author of John, he's speaking. The author is speaking from past experiences and also present happenings. But when we look at it, in that 19th verse, people love darkness instead of the light. In that 19th verse, people love darkness instead of light. At the beginning of the chapter, Nicodemus comes to Jesus under the cover of night.
Yeah.
Wait. He comes to Jesus in the nighttime because what? He don't want nobody to see him. So, brother, you remember when you used to creep at night because you sisters, y'all remember when you used to call him over at night? And so Nicodemus goes in the nighttime because he didn't want anybody to see him. And so the author of John is speaking also. Is speaking also because because John is written after Jesus' crucifixion. And so he realizes that here it is. People saw the light. Jesus was the light. Jesus was the truth of the world.
Yeah.
And those in the darkness wanted to destroy the light. See, if light was considered, if you had light, you saw what was happening around
you.
You knew what was going on.
Right.
And so by Jesus being crucified, the light was destroyed. And so the events of last weekend in Virginia, the rise of the alt-right, the Identity Europa, and white nationalists, they're trying to destroy the light that is in the world. They're trying to destroy the light that is in the world. All of the progress that we've made, we got a long way to go, but they're trying to destroy the light that is in the world. See, people love darkness so much. They're afraid of light. They're afraid of the light of Jesus Christ. They're afraid of what God is trying to do in the world. And the other thing in the text is, if you go to verse 20, people hate the light because of their evil deeds. Don't you know? See, people don't like, when folk want to do dirt, they don't want to be seen. And so they're going to do it in the nighttime. They're going to do it when no one can see them. They're going to try to do it under the cover of darkness. The powers that be had a problem with Jesus because he was the truth of the world.
Yeah.
And so when they came to get Jesus to crucify him, they didn't come in the middle of the day. They what? Came in the night. Wait, they came in the night. Not because it was the right time to catch him, but because they didn't want the people to see them apprehending him. And so in most cases, you get put in jail. I don't know if anybody ever been in jail. I guess y'all hadn't. Okay, so if you get locked up in the nighttime, you're going to have to spend the nighttime in jail. You're not going to see a judge in the nighttime. You're going to have to wait till the next morning. And if it's on a Friday night, you're going to be that whole, I tell you, y'all just some good Christian folk. When Jesus was captured, they didn't wait till the next morning. They went into meetings that same night to make sure that they could crucify him the next day. And so, people want to do their evil deeds in the night. The people were being taken advantage of by the Romans and the Jewish elite. Yes. The author is speaking to this whole notion that Jesus was shedding light on this. And so Jesus shedding light on this, they were trying to do their dirty deeds in the darkness. The topic of race is a hot button in the United States. It is a very hot button, and people don't want to talk about it. But those who love the light aren't afraid to talk about it.
Amen.
Those who marched, that young lady who was murdered,
amen,
she was not afraid to talk about an issue. An issue that needed to be spoken about.
Oh, yeah.
See, the reality is a spiritual eclipse will come. I don't care where you sit. I don't care how good you are. I don't care what kind of life you live.
That's right.
There's going to be. Just like there are always eclipses occurring on this planet.
Yeah.
There's always going to be some spiritual eclipses in your life. Satan is always seeking to come between you and Jesus.
Yeah,
and Satan is looking for the opportunity to step in front of you and Jesus. Satan is constantly seeking to step in your path and cause an eclipse of your soul. Jesus teaches us how to stare into a spiritual eclipse. He reminds us of the tools that we need to keep our eyes and to keep our eyes safe and keep our eyes on Him and know that He is ever present.
Yes.
Can I give you three and I'm going to get out your way? I'm going to get out. See, the first thing, when you're staring into a solar eclipse, you need corrected lenses.
Oh, yeah.
You need the correct lenses, right? You need really dark lenses. You need really dark lenses. Since looking directly into the sun can lead to permanent damage. The thing is, one of the reasons your eyes squint, it is a safety mechanism of your eyes to make sure your eyes, your pupils do not get too much light, because it can hurt. And so the thing about it is, if you get too much light in your eyes, you don't feel the effects right away. It happens over time. And so staring into a solar eclipse, you need protection. Wait. So when you're in the midst of a spiritual eclipse, wait, you need some protection. Y'all not hearing me. See, Jesus, wait. When Jesus was in the midst of a spiritual eclipse, what did He do? He always quoted the Word of God. Wait, hold up. So when your spiritual eclipse comes, you need to lift your Bible. Y'all. You need to lift your Bible. Oh, wait, y'all still ain't getting it. When your spiritual eclipses come, you need to rest on the Word of God. You need to lift the Word of God up, because the Word of God will see you through. See, and I'm reminded of Psalms 119, 105. Your Word is what? A lamp to my feet and a light to my path. When you have the Word of God in you, when you have the Word of God in your spirit, when spiritual eclipses come, you have something that will light your path. You have something that will stop you from stumbling. You have something that will lead your way. Now, we're in the midst of a spiritual eclipse. You need the correct lenses to move through that situation. The next thing is to experience an eclipse, you have to be in the proper location. All of the talk about this eclipse is you got to be in the right place. See, there are people, they're called umbrophiles. They follow eclipse. They chase eclipse. And umbra is actually Latin for a shadow. And so they chase shadows. And so you have to be in the proper location. See, eclipses are always occurring. And to see them, you must be in the proper location. Wait. Hold up. So Reverend Robinson, where you going? Many of us, we don't even know eclipses are happening in our lives. To really understand if you are in the midst of an eclipse, you got to be in the right place. Your spirit has to be in the right place. Your heart has to be in the right place. That means you got to have some church in you. You got to be carrying the church around with you. You have to have God in you. See, the eclipse tomorrow occurs in North America. And in 8 years, it'll be probably in Europe. And so in this, Jesus knew when a spiritual eclipse was coming, and He positioned Himself to encounter.
Yes.
And so anytime the Pharisees and the Sadducees came at Him, He was ready because he knew that God was inside of him. And he knew exactly what he was looking at. We must be, what does the text say? We must be wise as serpents and what? As harmless as doves. We have to be in the proper location. We have to have the correct lenses. And then we have to know the length of an eclipse. Wait, hold up. See, somebody is in the midst of a spiritual eclipse right now. You're in the middle, and you think it's going to last forever. But don't you know an eclipse can only last a certain length of time? The longest an eclipse can last is a maximum of 7 minutes. The eclipse tomorrow will last approximately 2 minutes and 45 seconds. Wait, so you thinking your spiritual eclipse is going to last forever. Don't you know that trouble don't last forever? Hold up. Trouble don't last always. We may endure for a night, but what? Joy comes in the morning. Jesus understood that the attacks will come, but what? They won't last. And you may put me in a borrowed tomb, but don't you know it won't last? I might be there for a day or two, but don't you know I'm going to get up regardless of whatever your situation is. Your eclipse is not going to last always. Doing a spiritual eclipse, staring at the sun, it doesn't blind you. Somebody just missed that. Staring at the S-O-N does not blind you. If you're in the midst of your spiritual eclipse, don't you know if you just stare at the S-O-N, it's going to be all right. If you're in the midst of trouble, you got a bad diagnosis, don't you know you just need to stare at the S-O-N. Y'all, now here, if you are in the midst of trouble with your kids, don't you know you need to stare at the S-O-N? If you're in the midst of going through some financial difficulties, don't you know you need to stare at the S-O-N? And if you are going through some trouble in your life, all you got to do is keep your eyes on the sun. Help is coming. Help is on the way. The thing about an eclipse is, the moon hides the sun, but don't you know that the sun is still there. The sun is still there. I'm reminded of Psalms 27:1. The Lord is what? My light and what? My salvation. Whom shall I fear? I'm reminded of Romans 13:12. The night is nearly over and the day is almost here. So let us put aside what? Let us put aside the darkness and put on the armor of light. I'm reminded of John 8:12b. I am what? The light of the world. Whom follow me will never walk in darkness, but will have light, the light of life. I'm reminded of 1 John 1:5. God is the light. In him there is no darkness at all. When the spiritual eclipses come, when it all comes, when you are find yourself in a bad situation, don't you know you got to put on the lenses and see the sun? You got to use the word of God so that you can see the sun. You got to use the word of God so that you can walk the path. You got to use the word of God so that you can go where God is leading you. And know weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. In the full eclipse. The thing is, there's always a corona. Wait. In a full eclipse, because the sun is bigger than anything that tries. The sun is bigger than anything that tries. But y'all still not getting it. The S-O-N is bigger than anything that tries to block it. So I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what might be happening in your life. But I do know we all experience spiritual eclipses. And we just have to be prepared to move through those situations. If we stand on the word of God and use that as a lens, don't you know our lives will be better for us? If we just position ourselves in such a way that we can see what the eclipse truly is, we can deal with it a little bit better. And when trouble gets really hard, know that trouble don't last always.
Man.
That eclipse can only last a certain length of time. Eventually, it's going to be over.
Oh, yeah.
Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet.